Hey game dev enjoyers, Pixrick here. Recently I made a video about interactive shadows in Unity and, well, you were quite a lot to ask for a tutorial. Like the previous tutorial, I will consider that you know the Unity basics, otherwise I would recommend checking out the CodeMonkeys channel for example to get used to Unity in general. Anyways, here's how to make interactive shadows in Unity. Interactive shadows rely essentially on creating a collider associated to the shadow. The concept is extremely simple. Considering a meshed game object, for each vertex of its mesh, you cast a ray in the direction of the light depending on what type of light this is, which will return a list of points that are the intersection between the ray casts and the colliders of the target layer, basically what intersects with the ground and the walls. I will call these points intersection points in the rest of the video. Then different approaches are possible to create the collider, either linking these intersection points to the base object vertices or extruding these points in a direction. We will see these different methods and their implementation. Also, what will follow is highly optimizable because it's a quite performance intensive method. I tried to optimize it myself and I will show you how, but I'm sure there is more to do, so please tell me your ideas for optimization in the comment section. For now, set up an example scene, create a simple 3D object like a cube, a cylinder or a sphere, doesn't matter, but move it a bit upward so that we can clearly see its shadow. Now create a C# script, call it interactive shadow, and apply it to the object and open it. Now let's create our variables. We need to reference the shadow transform, the light transform and type, the target layer mask of the ray casts, the extrusion direction, the object vertices, the shadow collider mesh, and the shadow collider. Okay, so first we have to initialize the shadow collider. We don't want the shadow collider to be a child of the object because otherwise it will scale and rotate with the parent. And it's a bad idea. We will create a method for that. Create a void method called, for example, initialize shadow collider. In this method, retrieve the shadow transform game object on which we will add the collider. You can add this line if you don't want to see it in the hierarchy. Next, you will create a mesh collider component on the game object and set this collider to convex. You can also set it to triggerable. It depends on what kind of interactions you want. Finally, call that method in the awake method. Why the awake method and not the start method? Because we want our collider to be initialized when other scripts call their start method. We also need to make the collider convex so that we don't have to determine the triangles of the mesh used in the collider by ourselves. The physics engine will do it for us. We just have to determine the vertices of the shadow collider mesh. It uses a quick hull algorithm that I will probably detail in the video to explain the volumetric shadows, if you're interested of course. Keep in mind that this is the most performance expensive process of the entire tutorial, so we will have to optimize its use. Then we determine the light type and we retrieve the object vertices from the object mesh. Finally, we initialize the shadow collider mesh. We want our shadow collider to follow the object, so set its position to the object position in the update method. Now we have to determine the position of the intersection points. For that we create a vector3 array method named compute shadow collider mesh vertices. Yeah, I love explicit names in programming. That returns an array of the shadow collider mesh vertices, as you probably guessed. First, we initialize a vector3 array that will contain the object vertices positions and the intersection points positions, so twice as long as the object vertices array. This is this array that the method will return. Then we initialize the raycast's direction as if it was a directional light, and then we iterate in a for loop to determine each intersection point for each object vertex. Now we have to get the world space position of the object vertex, because while scaling or rotating, the object vertex position will remain the same in the local space, but not in the world space. Then we will check if the light type is not directional, and if not, we change the raycast direction to match the point light and spotlight behavior. For the tutorial's sake, I suppose that we didn't use other type of light, but you can modify the script to include them as well. Finally, you can both compute the intersection point and the second point if there is an extrusion or not. Let's begin with computing the intersection point. Create a vector 3 function that takes in argument a vector 3 that represents the starting point of the raycast and a vector 3 that represents the direction of the raycast. Now create a raycast heat local variable to store some information on the heat point of the raycast. Then check if the raycast hits a collider of the target layer. If that's the case, return the intersection point in the local space, i.e. by subtracting transform.position to the intersection point position, which is in word space. And if the raycast do not hit something, return a very far position in the raycast direction. Now we just have to compute the second point, which will depend on whether there is an extrusion or not. Create another vector 3 function that takes in argument a vector 3 that represents the base object vertex position and a vector 3 that represents the shadow point position, which is actually the intersection point. Now check if the extrusion direction squared magnitude is equal to 0. If that's the case, return the object vertex position in local space, otherwise return the shadow point position, which is already in local space, plus the extrusion direction. We use the squared magnitude over the magnitude because we don't want to determine precisely the magnitude of the vector, and it saves a bit of memory. Now, in the compute shadow collider mesh vertices method, apply these methods for each pair of points of the array, which are separated by an index of n, which is the length of the object vertices array. Finally, in the fixed update method, update the shadow collider mesh vertices with the compute shadow collider mesh vertices method and apply that mesh to the shadow collider mesh. We use the fixed update method over the update method because every physics related stuff happens here. Back in Unity, make sure to create and or apply a layer to the objects that will receive the shadows. And finally, fill the interactive shadows variables and voila, you created a collider associated to your shadow. Well, you created a shadow collider indeed, but an extremely inefficient one. Let me show you why. For one interactive shadow, the result is okay, I mean regarding performance, and I have around 120 FPS. That's cool. Now let's duplicate the object and shadow so that we have now 100 interactive shadows running. Well, the FPS drops to about 2 FPS. And there are several reasons for that. First, we didn't optimize the object vertices array, and there are a lot of duplicates in it. To solve that issue, you just have to add .distinct.toArray after you get the object vertices. Make sure to use the namespace system.link, otherwise you won't be able to use the distinct method. For those who don't know, this method returns distinct elements from a data source, which is like removing duplicates from an array. This prevents unnecessary raycasts and saves a lot of memory. Second, we are updating the shadow collider even if the shadow is static, which means that the position, rotation and scale of the transform don't change. There is a built-in bool that checks if the transform of an object has changed. Unfortunately, it doesn't work and Unity never fixed it. Then we have to implement it ourselves. It's actually pretty easy, don't worry. Create three variables that will represent the last time where the position, rotation and scale of the object have been updated. Then create a bool method called transformHasChanged that will check if the position or the rotation or the scale of the object have changed since the last update. Now, in the fixed update method, instead of calling directly the update shadow collider method, we first check if the transform has changed since the last update. We also update the previous position, previous rotation, and previous scale variables. Please, Unity, fix this. My solution is so poor. Finally, we are updating the shadow collider the same rate as the fixed update method, which may be not that necessary. The idea is to update the collider less frequently so that we reduce the number of calls. This one is also fairly simple. Create a bool named canUpdateCollider and a float named shadowCollider_update_time, for example. You can set the float to a range so that it's nicer to manipulate in the inspector. Now, in the fixed update method, add a condition to update the shadow collider, which is that canUpdateCollider is true. Now convert these lines into a function named updateShadowCollider, for example. Then, instead of calling directly the updateShadowCollider method, we will call it through an invoke function with a delay of shadowCollider_update_time. We also set canUpdateCollider to false. Now, in the updateShadowCollider, set canUpdateCollider to true. So our optimizations are done. Now let's test them. Woohoo! We increased the FPS by about 5000%. Good job, everyone. If you come up with more optimizations, let me know in the comment section. Now it just remains the fun part. Let's make some scripts to add a behavior when the shadow collider is hit or triggered. I will consider that your shadow collider is triggerable like mine. First, let's make a script that deactivates a collider on trigger. We will call it deactivate collider on trigger, for example. Open it. Okay, so this script will be extremely simple. We just have to reference the target collider and disable it when onTrigger function is called. If you check the tag of the collider that triggers the shadow collider, like me, don't forget to add the tag on your object. We are almost done. When the shadow collider is refreshed, this is for the physics engine as if the refreshed collider is a new collider. What that means is that the onTriggerEntered method will be called again, since it's like you just entered in the collider. Then we have to set a bool to know if the previous collider has been triggered when entering the new one. So set the bool to true when entering the collider and to false when exiting. Also add a condition to check if the previous collider was not triggered. And yay! We made an interactive shadow! As a bonus, a useful script that calls a Unity event when triggering the collider. Unity events are quite nice to work with and are definitely good to test and tweak things, and I leave you a link in the description if you're interested in events in C# as well as Unity events. You can almost copy-paste the previous script, just change the variable to Unity event onShadow trigger, for example, and then just call it in the onTriggerEntered method. Don't forget to use the Unity.events namespace, otherwise you won't be able to use the Unity events. Back in Unity, you can add whatever behavior you want in the onShadow trigger event. And well, that's all for the video. Thank you all for watching, and I'll see you next time. Bye!